All right, out front now, Democratic Senator from Ohio, Sherrod Brown. And Senator, I appreciate your time tonight. Obviously an important night, the president coming to Capitol Hill. I do want to note that this, that we're learning here, these interviews with people within the Trump Organization is separate from Mueller's Russia investigation. It's coming from the Southern District in New York, which of course is responsible now for Michael Cohen impending prison sentence. What do you think is a bigger threat to President Trump, the Mueller investigation or what seems to be going on in New York?
Well, I'm not a lawyer, and I don't try to measure one threat to the president against the other. And I just say law enforcement needs to do its job. The bigger threat to the American people is President Trump measures the economy by the stock market, an economy that a presidency that's enriching him and his family. And I measure the economy by what's happening with workers' wages, what's happening to the dignity of work, what's happening to the cost of health care, what's happening to the cost of education. And the president would rather distract and change the subject than focus on workers' wages. I've seen the betrayal of workers in Youngstown, Ohio, with the GM closing. I've seen the betrayal of workers where workers' wages are flat while profits are up for corporations. So that, to me, is the bigger story. I just want law enforcement to do its job.
So, though, when he says, as he will, that African-American unemployment is a record low, is that something that he deserves credit for, that deserves standing applause?
Well, it doesn't matter who gets credit. I mean, I saw when we rescued the auto industry 10 years ago, we've had 10 years of economic growth, 10 years of increased jobs, and that's great that the African-American unemployment rate is lower. But dignity of work means that workers' wages go up, too. We see corporate profits go up. We see skyrocketing executive compensation. We see productivity going up, but wages are flat. And women and people of color have even more challenges with flat wages. And that's the real issue, not somebody having two or three jobs that pay $11 or $12 an hour, white or black or Latino, but people not making wages that can keep up with inflation and pay for their prescription drugs and pay for their kids' school and all the other things that we need.
Prescription drugs, obviously, he is going to call for those prices to come down, which obviously is something you agree with. And in fact, Senator, when I looked at the past, what I think is very interesting is you had a lot of the same things to say long before President Trump actually said them. Even put America first echoes you. In fact, you said that, Senator Brown, more than a decade ago. Let me show you and everyone who's watching who may not be aware some of the echoes between you and President Trump.
Well,
in all things, it's time to put Americans first.
It's time to put Americans first.
We have to have fair trade deals.
It's about standing up for fair trade.
This wave of globalization has wiped out totally our middle class.
A big part of the reason wages are flat is because we have not done globalization well.
You sound the same.
Well, it's the same on the surface, except that President Trump has played off American workers against foreign workers. President Trump won't adopt a Buy America policy for America's infrastructure, building bridges, buying steel, all of that. President Trump's engaged in racist rhetoric, which I will never, ever, and have never, ever done, when he demonizes immigrants. I mean, it's his is a phony populism that pushes, that divides and pushes people down. Real populism is never racist. It's never anti-Semitic. It never divides. It lifts workers up. Real populists don't give tax cuts to rich people like this phony populism from the president of the United States does.
So let me ask you about taxes, because there is a big debate right now on that issue, right? If you want to say what real populism is as opposed to phony populism. The big debate that's going to come up here is whether raising taxes is the way to address inequality in this country or whether that can better be done through increased economic growth. Elizabeth Warren has that wealth tax idea, right? 2-3% on all assets for the very wealthy. Cory Booker has talked about the rich people funding savings accounts for the less well-off. Congressman Ocasio-Cortez, who, of course, is not running but has gotten a lot of air out of the room with her proposal to nearly double federal taxes on the wealthiest in this country to 70%. Do you support any of these proposals in the specific nature, 70% taxes, savings accounts?
I'll answer it this way. 2 years ago, I presented to the Senate Finance Committee and to the President of the United States my Patriotic Corporation Act, which did one simple thing. It said if you pay good wages and you provide decent benefits and
you do your production in the United States, you get a lower tax rate. And at the same time, the Family Tax Relief Act, which focused the earned income tax credit, if you make $30,000, $40,000, $50,000, $60,000 a year, you got money in your pocket back in your taxes. So fundamentally, you want a tax system that puts money in the pockets of middle-class, hardworking families, and that takes away the incentives for companies to shut down production in Dubuque or in Manchester and move production overseas and get a tax break. So that's how my focus of tax reform is. You take away the big tax cut that President Trump gave to companies and to individuals, and you build a tax system that helps middle-class families, puts money in their pockets, and stops the moving of overseas.
So to understand it specifically, would you raise that corporate tax rate from where it is now, from what he lowered it? Would you go ahead and actively raise corporate taxes?
The corporate tax rate under the I would start with scaling back overall the Trump tax cut and replace it with incentives for companies to manufacture here, incentives for Buy America, putting money in the pockets of middle-class taxpayers. I'm not going to pick one or two or three pieces of food off the menu, servings off the menu. I'm going to pull it together in a tax bill that gives incentives for companies to stay here. The president's tax bill actually gives a 50% off coupon for companies that shut down in Cedar Rapids, Iowa, and move overseas to a city in Mexico. I mean, it makes no sense. The president's done that because in the end, this presidency's about putting money in his family's pockets and in the pockets of his fellow New York billionaires. It's not about folks in the middle class. And that's why he's betrayed workers in this country.
So, you know, when you said back in 2006, which I just played, it's time to put Americans first. Now he says it's time to put Americans first in 2016 was the soundbite I used. So we're talking 10 years apart. But obviously, part of the reason this is so important is you are perceived as someone who is very likely to run for the White House yourself. I don't know if you heard Senator Beto O'Rourke just told Oprah he is going to decide if he's running by the end of the month. So that's another person about to decide. What's your latest thinking for when you will formally tell us if you're running for the White House?
Well, let me address. Probably March, Connie and I will decide. We're doing a dignity of work listening tour. I don't go to these early states looking for big crowds. I'm going and listening to workers and listening to farmers and listening to people talk about their lives. But go back to the putting America first that you've a video of or whatever that I've said many, many times. It's about putting workers first, but it's not about racism. It's never about beating up on foreign workers. It's never talking about dividing in this phony populism. I think it's important to make that distinction that to me, it's about lifting workers up in all countries. And that's how you put our country first, because if you raise wages in Mexico and the U.S. with a real change in the North American Free Trade Agreement, a really good negotiated agreement, you lift workers in both countries, and Mexicans will be able to buy more American cars, or Americans will buy Mexican products, and it lifts all boats, and that's what trade's all about.
All right, Senator Brown, I appreciate your time. Thank you.
Of course. Thanks, Erin.